Now it is time for Dr. Muhammad Khalid Masud to give his keynote address. Dr. Masud is a renowned scholar whose publications include Shatibi's Philosophy of Islamic Law and Iqbal's Reconstruction of Ijtihad. He is the honorary ad hoc member Sharia Appellate Bench of the Supreme Court of Pakistan. He was previously a visiting professor at the International Islamic University of Malaysia. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Muhammad Khalid Masud to the stage for his keynote address.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Your Excellencies, distinguished scholars, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu Alaikum. I must thank Istanbul Network for Liberty for giving me this opportunity. But let me explain, although I am introduced as a keynote speaker, it's just a draft, and I have been revising it since I submitted, and it's a 10th revision that I have been working while traveling. So although the paper has been distributed, I would prefer to read the latest revision. I very much hope that your comments and discussions will help me further improve it. The paper explores the reasons for reluctant democratic transition in current Muslim societies against the backdrop of tensions between the secularists, Islamists, and terrorists. Secularists consider an Islamic state impossible because Islam, they argue, is essentially undemocratic. Islamists accept democracy but reject secularism because they understand that secularism eliminates religion from public sphere. Those who use violence to change or effect change, the terrorists I mean, construct a vision for an Islamic state that is empty of any democratic content. In trying to understand these multiple narratives, one thing that strikes me is that the current comparative literature and methodologies are wanting as they essentialize certain norms and practices. Ernest Gellner, his book in 1996, for instance, characterizes Islam as secularism resistant. Most others regard Islamic law as fixed and varying in the Muslim theories and practices. Alfred Stepan, in his book in 2012, disagrees with Gellner, as he found in the West multiple secularisms and noticed democratic transition in progress in some post-Arab Spring Muslim societies. He observes that religious leaders were prepared to grant authority to elected representatives and that the state authorities facilitate religious groups' democratic participation in civil and political domains. He refers to this as twin tolerations, that is, the minimal boundaries of freedom of action that must somehow be crafted for political institutions vis-a-vis religious authorities, and for religious individuals and groups vis-a-vis political institutions. In this paper, I will confine my presentation to examining the classical doctrine of religion and politics as twin brothers, to argue that Muslim political thought has been truly pragmatic to the issue of separation and assimilation of religion and politics. I propose to examine this doctrine of twin brothers, religion and politics, or the religious and the political, as an answer to the question of relationship. I will explore this relationship with reference to debates about bid'ah, tashabbuh bil kuffar, siyasa, secularism, the four doctrines defining the boundaries of religion and politics. The paper is divided into four sections. The first section deals with the doctrine of twin brothers. Debates in Muslim society over the relationship between religion and politics began quite early in Islam, but they became more prominent during the early Abbasid period. Ibn Muqaffa, who died in 759, Caliph Mansur's secretary, was alarmed by the religious schism in the caliphate. freedom of just juristic opinion had given rise to divergent fatwa and conflicting court judgments. He advised the Caliph to use his prerogative to unify the laws. Caliph Mansur approached Imam Malik in 8th century in Medina to allow his compilation of laws, Al-Muwatta, to make the law of the Caliphate. Imam Malik refused, arguing that this would deprive the jurists from the freedom of interpretation. Generally, a demarcation between the roles of the political and the religious became part of the legal and religious language since the debates between the Kharijites, who claimed that sovereignty belonged to God alone. Caliph Ali replied that it was wrong to confuse human with divine sovereignty. Al-Juwayni, in 11th century, considered that the necessity of establishing the state was not religious. It was a social need. He argued that obligation of appointing an imam was not derived from the Quran or Hadith. It was established by the consensus of the Muslim community. Obligation to obey the ruler was, however, a religious duty. Gradually, the political authority became absolute with the Abbasid period. A caliph was no longer elected by the people in the Umayyad period. Abbasid caliphs began to claim divine rights to rule. The caliphs tried to claim authority in the domain of theology and law also, and used courts to define heresy and to unify laws. The jurists insisted on distinguishing between the authority to govern and the authority to interpret law. In the beginning, they were reluctant to accept the position of judges, but gradually they came to recognize the authority of the ruler to enforce law. The doctrine, religion and kingship are twin brothers, ad-din wal-mulk, tau-aman, emerged in the 10th century after a huge political crisis between the authority of the caliph and the sultan. I will detail that crisis later. Here it is important to note that the sultan, the army chief, had more authority than the caliph. It was understood that the sultan had truly executive authority, and the caliph was a figurehead to fulfill the religious necessity. This doctrine of twin brothers was the hallmark of a short duration called the Abbasid revival, that is 920 to 932. When the caliphs reclaimed their political authority from the powerful army emirs, who had reduced the political authority of the caliph. This statement, as a basic principle of politics, appears in the books on theology, political theory, history, ethics, tafsir, hadith literature during this short period. Qudama bin Jafar, 10th century, secretary to the Abbasid caliph during the Abbasid revival, is apparently the first to adopt this statement as a political theory. He attributed this statement to the Persian emperor Ardashir I, emperor of Persia in 224 to 241, and the founder of the Sassanid Empire that derived its authority from Zoroastrian religion. Qudama explained that the two authorities are combined in caliph because no kingdom survives without religion and law, and no religion functioned without kingdom and control. The doctrine in the beginning marked the revival of the Abbasid claim to political as well as religious authority. This revival was for a short period. As soon as army leaders took over the powers and the caliph became the nominal head, consequently, the doctrine in the 11th century came to be recognized as the authority of the sultan. Nizam-ul-Mulk Tusi in 1092, Siyasat-nama, famously known for the statement of twin brothers, provides an insight into the art of political management in this chaotic period. Tusi served as wazir of the Seljuk Sultan Al-Parsalan and Malik Shah the First in the periods of the Caliph Al-Qaim bi Amrillah and Al-Muqtadi bi Amrillah. In this statement, the term Tau Aman, twin brothers, meaning to have the same source, inseparable, indistinguishable, interdependent, and having equal position is politically quite relevant. It implies that this relationship is the law of nature and a biological fact. Nizam-ul-Mulk Tusi took three steps to consolidate this theory, combining the political and the religious authority in the Sultan. First, he wrote Siyasatnama, advising the Seljuk Sultan Alp-Arslan to acquire religious knowledge enough to distinguish between heresy and authentic religion to protect himself and his kingdom from the enemy propaganda of rival Fatimid state. Second, he assigned Al-Ghazali to write a book on the heresies of Batinis, which he wrote Fazaih al-Batiniyah. The book offered a whole new theology to counter the enemy propaganda. It is in this book that Al-Ghazali cited the above-mentioned hadith. Third, he established the chain of colleges called Madaris Nizamiya, after his name, to train religious scholars, muftis, qazis, and state officials to lead the religious discourse. Al-Ghazali legitimized the authority of the Sultan in view of public interest, as I will explain later. Al-Ghazali is arguably the first to cite the statement of twin brothers as hadith. Ibn Abbas reported that Prophet, peace be upon him, said Islam and Sultan are twin brothers. This hadith appears in the 12th century in hadith collections and commentaries of the Quran with certain variations which are not relevant to the present discussion. Al-Sagani, however, considered this report fabricated. The doctrine of twin brothers could not take root because Tusi was assassinated, Al-Ghazali went into hiding, and Alp-Arslan was killed in mysterious circumstances. Because of this power play in that period, the progress of this political approach and the debate about the political and the religious as twin brothers continued, but stressing separation rather than assimilation. In the second section, I'm talking about the religious brother. Islam recognizes diversity of religion in the diversity of religions and in religions. The recognition of diversity required definition of boundaries of religion as well as the religious other in several different ways. I take up two doctrines, bidah, heretical innovation, which distinguish between religion and non-religion, and the tashabbuh bil kufar, imitation of the infidel, which defines the religious other. To illustrate the boundaries between these terms. This distinction also meant to delimit the religious authority and that only the Prophet had. This is a very important point, that it was the debate what religious authority is being transferred or being inherited by the scholars. So the emphasis was to delimit the religious authority that the Prophet had and that could not be transferred to anybody else. These boundaries were blurred in modern times when establishment of state was received, was perceived as a religious necessity, and the boundaries of religion had to be expanded to assimilate political and religious authorities. Some modern religious leaders expanded the political domain of the state into the religious sphere to wield absolute authority in both spheres. Maulana Maududi, for instance, considered the term deen almost synonymous with state. He argued that the concept of deen was too unique and too comprehensive to be translated in any language. He concluded that the modern world state has reached somewhere closer to it, closer to religion, but it's not yet broad enough to include the whole semantic field to which the word deen, religion, refers. Now coming to bidah. Al-bidah is an important doctrine which distinguishes the religious from the non-religious. Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi in 14th century underscored the significance of four constituent elements that make innovation, a new idea, or a practice a bidah. Number one, intending and believing that the innovation is religious. Number two, claiming the status of religious obligation for that innovation. Third, exaggerating emphasis on its religious nature. And fourthly, considering this practice as a way of seeking God's pleasure. Shatvi did not consider all innovations and practices as bid'ah. For example, living in built-up houses in place of huts is not bid'ah, because this practice has nothing to do with belief and religion. He clarifies that most bid'ah innovations are introduced in ibadat as ibadat. He gives an example that would have sounded far-fetched in his period. He says, suppose a person who travels to perform the obligation of Hajj, flying in the air or walking on the water, would not be counted as innovator in religion or heretic. The purpose is to reach Mecca to perform the obligation of Hajj, and he achieves that purpose in its fullest sense. Coming to the tashabbuh bil kufar, this prohibition of imitating the infidel, tashabbuh bil kufar, is derived from the hadith, whoever imitates a people, he belongs to them. Varying versions of this statement are reported in hadith collections and suggest that the doctrine was developed to define boundaries between the religious other, to define the boundaries how the religion is objectified. Firstly, the doctrine defines Muslim identity. It is not similarity or commonality per se. Secondly, it differentiates between religious and cultural and political symbols of identity. Socializing with non-Muslims is not regarded as tashabbuh. I will illustrate with four examples from medieval and modern periods that generalization of this prohibition, diversity in its interpretation, and widening its implications occurred in changing cultural, political, and religious context. Al-Ghazali in 12th century explained this prohibition in the hadith with reference to historical context. He argued that even though Muslims were open and eager to share religious commonalities with the Jews in Medina, the Jews did not welcome it. The Jews were not happy with the rising political power of Islam. Hence, the hadith required Muslims to distance from the Jews as the religious and the political other. Tashabbuh is a religious, in the religious sense, was defined as a social and cultural differentiation on the part of religion. The situation became more complex in 19th century colonial India, for instance, where Muslims were a minority living under foreign rulers who were Christians. Yet the Muslim jurists distinguished the religious from the political. Shah Abdul Aziz in 19th century ruled that sharing gifts with non-Muslims, dressing like them, eating with them, greeting them, attending their festivals, and accepting gifts and foods distributed at these festivals, and anything, custom, practice, food, and dress that is considered by non-Muslims as religious is not allowed for Muslims. Adopting these practices with the sole intent to imitate in a strictly religious manner was prohibited. However, if Muslims adopted them for being useful and convenience and not with the intention of imitating their religion, it is not forbidden. For example, wearing a warm dress that non-Muslims wear in winter in their countries is not a religious practice and therefore is not forbidden. The context was that most of the Muslim scholars at that time said that by wearing an English dress one becomes a Christian. Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, his contemporary, ruled that cross is a symbol of Christianity and therefore its wearing by Muslim is imitation. and but hat, coat, and pantaloon are not religious symbols, as Muslims in England also wear these items. In India, however, since it was regarded as imitation of the English, and therefore Rashid Gangohi forbade it. Most Muftis in 19th century declared speaking and learning English as tashabbuh and forbade it. Mufti Abdul Hay clarified that learning English was not prohibited. Tashabbuh referred to special customs and habits which were peculiar with non-Muslims. So while this might include certain food, drink, and dress, it may entail tashabbuh, but it does not include languages. Mufti Abdul Hay disallowed wooden sandals used by Hindu yogis. Mufti Rashid Ahmad Gangohi clarified that they no longer symbolized yogis and were therefore allowed for Muslims. These contradictory fatwas were based on the political perception of Muslim identity. It is also important to note that some of these muftis who believed in Hindu-Muslim unity politically distinguished between Christians and Hindus. Mufti Abdul Hay of Rangi Mahal, for example, ruled that killing a cow and eating its meat was not a religious obligation for Muslims in India. It must be avoided if it leads to religious disorder because Hindus worship cow. We have seen how the religious boundaries were continuously drawn and redrawn to respond to the changing political contexts. I detail in the next section how religion was reimagined in the form of state and ideology, and consequently, while religion was reimagined, it expanded to include also the politics. The politics was also Islamized to the extent of ideology that defined secularism as denial of religion. Now coming to the third section, the political. Siyasa and Sharia, as the political and the religious, were often contrasted in Islamic jurisprudence and political thought as mutually exclusive. Siyasa, as the domain of the ruler, was open and dynamic, and Sharia was considered fixed and immutable. Secularism is often described as Siyasa without Sharia. This section overviews the debates on two doctrines, Siyasa and secularism. Ibn Nujaym in the 16th century defines siyasa, action taken by a ruler in view of public interest in a certain matter, even though the ruler found no textual evidence to support his action. The debate about the boundaries between siyasa and sharia in Islamic law began more prominently in the 9th century when, as I mentioned above, the Abbasid introduced new courts, mazalim appeals, where the rulers used their discretion in public interest. The debate on siyasa emerged intermittently as and when the system faced a crisis. I have noticed five major shifts in the meaning of doctrine of siyasa in the history of Islamic legal and political theories. First was the 8th to 9th century, where siyasa means ruler's discretion. As mentioned above, the first political crisis came with the Abbasid Caliph Mansur, who tried to use this discretion to unify laws and to establish caliphal authority, to legislate and adjudicate Islamic law. Imam Shafi'i in the 9th century, who insisted on introducing laws only from the text of the Quran and Sunnah, and criticized the Hanafi principle of juristic preference, rejected the notion of siyasa as ruler's discretion. He allowed it only if it accorded with the text in the Quran and Sunnah. Other jurists developed notion of siyasa as ruler's discretion in the meaning of ta'zir, to define boundaries between the rights of God and the rights of humans. The crimes whose punishments were fixed by Sharia were categorized as rights of God and designated as hudud, meaning boundaries not to be crossed. Remaining crimes were considered the rights of humans and designated as tazir or tazirat, were left to the discretion of the ruler. Second crisis came in the 11th and 12th century when siyasa came to mean public interest. The second political crisis, that I'm mentioning, came when the newly emerging position of the Sultan claimed political authority against the Caliph in 12th century. As mentioned above, this is the time when twin brother theory became the official doctrine to justify the legitimacy of Sultan along with Caliph. Historically, Abbasid Caliphate had been under constant threat by neighboring states for almost a century. The Caliphs depended on armies to defend the Caliphate against these threats and political disorder. Military emirs claimed the position of Sultan, executive authority, and kept the position of Caliph for legal and religious justification. They used this authority to appoint and depose the Caliphs at their will. Al-Ghazali and other jurists recognized this form of rule by the force and called it istila. Al-Ghazali rationalized it with the theory of siyasa that distinguished the political from the religious siyasa. He said the religious siyasa is linked with the prophetic siyasa to subject Muslims to religious discipline, and the political was the executive authority of the ruling, like kings. So there was in Ghazali's thought, there was a division between two types of siyasa. Al-Ghazali defined the latter, that is the political siyasa, social organization and cooperation for economic resources and their management. The third crisis came in the 13th and 14th century with the Mongols, who put an end to the Abbasid Caliphate in Baghdad. The Mamluks shifted the Caliphate from Baghdad to Cairo. This Caliphate was constantly at war under threat. The recognized Caliphate gave more executive authority to sultans and kept Caliph as legal formality. As the crisis of rule of law related more specifically to crimes, wars, rules of exception, and harsh punishments, siyasa in this period came to mean political authority to establish discipline and order. Al-Kharafi, in the 13th century, developed a hierarchical theory of siyasa, defining boundaries between the authorities of Imam and the Qazi and the Mufti. Mufti as a religious authority was responsible to God alone, and Qazi to the Imam. The Imam had the final authority. Ibn Taymiyyah in 14th century, on the other hand, combined both religious and political authority in al-siyasa al-shara'iyya in the Caliph. He disagreed with the separation of religion and political authorities. He gave both powers to the ruler under Sharia because state was necessitated, according to him, by religion and was responsible to enforce Sharia. The fourth political challenge came with the rise of Mughal, Safavid, and the Ottoman empires, the empire period, during the 16th and 17th centuries. The political authority became absolute and hierarchical order. Siyasa in this period was defined as balance of power. The jurists, as officials of the state, participated in systematization of Islamic legal order, producing code-like compilations like Multaqa al-Abhur under the Ottomans and Fatawa Alamgiri in the Mughals under the Mughals. Emperors introduced their own laws, Qanun, in the Ottoman Empire, and Farman or Ayin in the Mughal India, in addition to Sharia, sometimes even contrary to fiqh. Al-Maqrizi in 15th century argued that the term siyasa was actually constructed on the pattern of Mongol yasa, only the scene was added to it. And he defined siyasa seeking the welfare of the people by leading them to the way of success in this and the other world. According to him, siyasa was of two types, prophetic and coercive. The first was ruled by Sharia, and the second was by pragmatism. Shah Waliullah in Mughal India also defined siyasa as balance of powers, assimilating the various doctrines of siyasa by philosophers and jurists. He stressed the need for deconstruction of all old systems, fakkukulli nizam, and construct a new one on the siyasa of balance and public interest. The fifth crisis came in the long period of 18th to 21st century, which is siyasa has become to mean political legitimacy. It is quite interesting that the doctrine of siyasa was also invoked by the colonial rulers in India. Warren Hastings, the British governor in India in 18th century, assumed the title Nawab General, Nawab Governor General Hastings, to claim the prerogative of a Muslim ruler to reform Islamic criminal law. He justified these reforms on the grounds of the doctrine of siyasa. Literature on siyasa grew abundantly in 19th and 20th century. The term siyasa came to be distinguished as public law in contrast to Sharia, and that came to mean personal laws. Now come to secularism. Some modern Muslim thinkers relate the issue of secularism to sovereignty and believe that secularism challenges divine sovereignty. According to the Irish political scientist Kathleen Kavanagh, it is possible to speak about sovereignty apart from secularism. It is useful to distinguish between different forms of sovereignty. The sovereignty that vested in state, sovereignty that vested in the figure who possesses authority, and sovereignty as the supreme and independent power or authority in government as possessed or claimed by a state or community. The debate about sovereignty in modern Muslim political thought really refers to the rise of modern nation state in the 19th and 20th century in a geographical region also called the West. Secularism is certainly part of how democracy is conceived, but is not linked to sovereignty. Democracy is about a form of governance. Niazi Berkes, a sociologist from Turkey, views secularism as a problem of modernization. It does not originate with religion or state. The societies where the social and political were not organized on religious basis in pre-modern period could easily separate the political from the religious. Unlike Christian Muslim societies, who treated the religious and the political as interdependent, were divided between the traditional conservative, the modernist, and the religious reformist. The traditional conservative was strictly religious but accommodative. The modernist was not religious and had no problem with secularism. It was the religious reformist who called for the revival of religion and contested modernity and the modernists. The Ottoman society was not organized on religious basis. It combined religion and political both. It was the difficulty of continuing this combination that created tension in modern Turkey. In the modern context, secularism has been subject of debate more heatedly after the abolition of the caliphate in 1924. In the modern context, secularism was approached from at least three different perspectives: sociological, epistemological, and ideological. In Southeast Asia, the religious, cultural, and ethnic diversity turned secularism into an epistemological issue. Professor Naqib al-Attas called for Islamization of knowledge as religion and culture came to be considered source of knowledge for the definition of Muslim society, Muslim identity. To Naqib al-Attas, the term secular has a dual connotation of both time and location. Now and this world. Distinguishing secularization from secularism, he explained that secularization in the West is understood as a social process that liberates man first from religion and then from metaphysical control over his reason and his language. He defines secularism, like religion, as an ideology that projects a closed worldview, an absolute set of values in line with an ultimate historical purpose having a final significance for men. In Egypt, the debate began after the abolition of the caliphate in 1924. Ali Abdul Razif argument that Muslims were not obliged to establish or restore the caliphate was rejected by Al-Azhar. Muslim Brotherhood, founded in 1928, rejected separation between religion and politics and argued that it was Muslim religious duty to establish Islamic State. Yusuf al-Qaradawi, affiliated with the Muslim Brotherhood, defined secularism as Western, anti-religious, and atheist ideology. He called those Muslims who support secularism apostates. In Tunisia, Rashid Ghannouchi, the leader of An-Nahda, an Islamic political party, has recently revisited secularism. He argues that secularism is not an ideology or theory. It is not monolithic, as there is a multitude of secularism. Western secularism is not only a procedural solution. Islam combined religion and politics since its beginning with the social contract of Medina, Misaq Medina, that combined people of different religions and beliefs into one political community. Within Islam, the approach is to distinguish rather than to separate, and is not about separation between religion and politics. In Islamic law, distinction is made similarly between human and divine, reason and revelation, ibadat and muamalat, the rights of people and the rights of God, the state and religion. Secularism does not mean expulsion of religion from politics. It will be dangerous. It reduces the state to be like a gang of mafia, his words, without moral restraint. Social harmony needs balance. To achieve this balance, we need to go back to the issue of distinguishing between religion and politics and adjust the parameters constant in religion and which is variable. To Ghannouchi, secularism is not an atheistic philosophy, but merely a set of procedural arrangements designed to safeguard the freedom of belief and thought. Defining the Islamic State, he says the state is Islamic insofar as it assures that its actions are in accordance with Islamic values without being subjected to the tutelage of any religious institution. For there is no such thing in Islam. Rather, there is a people and a notion and a nation who make decisions through their institutions. In South Asia, secularism was seen from three different perspectives: traditional, historical, and ideological. Qari Tayyib's book, The Natural State, illustrates the traditional view. In his view, the nature symbolizes the divine kingdom, which is the best example of a balanced system. In his view, only the religious scholars can decide between equivocal issues because they are well equipped to engage in the required legislative process and are well versed in philosophy of law. The opinion of the ordinary people has no value, even if they have total consensus about a certain matter. Muhammad Iqbal approached secularism historically. He explained that separation of religion and politics was a functional division in the management of the body politic. According to him, the Islamic idea of division of the religious and the political functions of the state must not be confounded with the European idea of separation of church and state. The former is only a division of functions. The latter is based on the metaphysical dualism of spirit and matter. Maulana Maududi viewed secularism as an ideology of la diniyat, denial and absence of religion. It is opposed to Islamic ideology, which is based on the two principles of sovereignty of God and enforcement of Sharia. Maududi called Islamic State a theodemocracy because Islamic State is not a ladini jamhuriyat. Sovereignty does not belong to the people. In Islam, people are not free to make their own laws. Maulana Maududi considered the term deen too unique and comprehensive to be translated in any language. The fourth and the final part is on the social, and this is something new that has been added in the Islamic political thought. In these debates, I find Imam al-Haramain, Abu Ma'ali al-Juwaini, in the 11th century, his book Ghiyas al-Umam fi Iltiyas al-Zulam, Helping the Communities in the World Wrapped in Darkness, is immensely relevant. Even the title of the book indicates his concern with the environment of tyranny and oppression and his attempt to save the community from this dark era. He clarified that after the death of the Prophet, religious authority was restricted to the Quran and Sunnah, and matters were decided by the consensus of the community. Fiqh, as understanding of Sharia, developed initially as multiple voices. Ghiyasul Umam aimed to help the masses against oppression and the increased oppression of the rulers and officials. He observed, the ulama had lost caution and balance, leaders and the middle classes had no piety. My attempt is to put the grinding wheel in place. Al-Juwayni, however, disagreed with those who held the establishment of state was a religious obligation created by religious texts. He discussed in detail how such claims were unfounded. He clarified that this necessity was created by the community and legitimized by ijma, the consensus of the masses. Once a leader, an imam or amir, a ruler is elected and appointed, then religious duty obliges its followers to obey him. According to Al-Juwayni, God was not obliged to send prophets. If that was the case, there would have been no fatra, period without prophet. Also, if that were the case, prophecy would have continued after Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. That means sending prophets was not a natural necessity, not a norm, not a divine obligation. The religious role of an imam is certainly lesser than the prophet. If it is possible to have a time without prophet, it is even more logical to have a period without an imam religiously. Secondly, it is not God's obligation to save the people, according to him. Even the prophet was not sent as savior. His duty was to deliver the divine message. The prophet organized society, established a community, and guided them to run their affairs. He did not force people to follow him or punish those who did not. He guided only those who agreed to follow him. God says clearly that the prophet was not a musaytir, not a dictator. And also God says, God does not change the conditions of the people unless they change themselves. Thirdly, while the prophet was chosen by God, an imam is chosen by the community. So it is the consensus of the community that is the source of legitimacy for imam. The role of imam is central as leader. The imamah as an institution is comprehensive. It includes protection of the territory, care of the subjects, establishing the call for Islam with rational and military support, and saving the oppressed from the oppressor. The imam's legal authority relates to two types of laws, public law and the social laws. In other words, imam's legal authority relates to public law and administration. The jurists, as members of the Muslim community, are situated between the ruler and the masses. They participate in formulating and completing the laws. As pillars of knowledge and piety, they must be qualified to exercise ijtihad, legal interpretation, because the people trust them for transmitting the authentic and reliable rules in Sharia. According to Juwayni, the source of political as well as religious authority in the Muslim community and ijma is the process to exercise this authority. I leave the discussion, although this is something very unique and new in Al-Juwayni, that ijma is not the consensus of the ulama, but it's the consensus of the masses. Masses participate in it. To conclude, the reasons for the reluctant democratic transition needs to be explored in the perception of state in modern Muslim political thought. Medieval Muslim thought has been pragmatic. Establishing a state was not regarded as a religious necessity. Rule of law, being a principle of governance, obedience to the ruler was a religious obligation. The above brief analysis of the doctrines of twin brothers, Siyasa, suggests that the Muslim political theories responded to major political crises with the redefinition of political and religious authority from the perspective of justice, public interest, and rule of law. The doctrine of twin brothers stressed upon the separation as well as the interdependence of the political and the religious in Islamic political thought. No individual or institution can claim religious authority that the Prophet had. Difference of opinion in religious and political matters was finally decided by the consensus of the Muslim community. Some modern Muslim political thinkers who perceive religion as political public action affect democratic transition and make Muslim societies reluctant because they tend to expand the boundaries of religion to define it as an ideology of power. Thank you very much.